Psalm 19. Now this is part 1. We're going to go through the first 8 verses of the chapter. Now this is a very important chapter of Scripture. It's a very long chapter as well. But there's a lot of important details that I want to pull out. And so basically how I will be expounding upon this passage is going verse by verse, and then basically reading the verse and then commenting on it, encouraging you with more of a deeper understanding of what other scriptures say. I won't go into deep reading of other scriptural passages. There'll be one or two that we'll take a look at, but I'll primarily just be emphasizing the principles that are found in many of the New Testament passages and throughout the Word of God. So with that said, let's get started. Verse 1 of Psalm 19 says, "Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord." Let me read that again. "Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord." It is a blessing to be undefiled, to not pollute yourself with sin. And I want to show you one passage here in James 4:4, which says, "Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Blessed is the man who is undefiled in his way, who walks in the law of the Lord." Walk in the way of the Lord, for there you shall find the blessing of the Lord and peace that passes all understanding. When God becomes your all-consuming focus and desire, you will walk after Him. And as we walk after Christ, wholeheartedly and daily and faithfully taking up our crosses and following Jesus, we will stay on the narrow road. Be not overconfident lest you fall, but remain undefiled from blatant sin. In addition, when we walk in the law of the Lord, when we walk undefiled in the way, we will walk according to God's rules, His standards of right and wrong, as we draw near to Him and learn His Word. Verse 2, "Blessed are they which keep His testimonies, and they that seek Him with the whole heart." Blessed are they that keep His testimonies, and that seek Him with the whole heart. If you seek God with your whole heart, you will be blessed. All throughout the Scriptures, we find that God wants a relationship with us based on us seeking Him and relying upon Him. He desires to be our Father, friend, and Lord. But you have a choice. He will not force you to follow Him. But if you will not choose Him, that doesn't mean that He won't punish your sins. It is perfectly righteous and just for the wicked to receive their punishment. However, if you seek Him with your whole heart, wow, as I remember that phrase, if you seek Him with your whole heart, it's a phrase that was spoken to Solomon by his father David, the man after God's own heart, and was repeated throughout the books of Kings and Chronicles, that if the kings would simply seek the Lord and follow Him, that they would be blessed. Keep the Lord's testimonies, dear friend. Seek Him with thy whole heart. For the Lord is more important than all else. He will guide you. He will be a father to you. He will knit up your broken heart. He will teach you what you do not yet know. And He will protect you from the enemy. Our gracious God should be given the first place in our lives and hearts. Yea, all our strength, mind, and soul. He deserves your whole heart. Verse 3. They also do no iniquity. They walk in His ways. They also do no iniquity. they walk in his ways. Iniquity has several definitions. Lawlessness, sins, transgression, and guilt are a few of the popular ones. As you are following the Lord, you will not be living a life full of transgressions of God's ways, but rather walking in the joy of the Holy Spirit. They do no iniquity. They walk in His ways. Verse 4, Thou hast commanded us to keep Thy precepts diligently. Thou hast commanded us to keep Thy precepts diligently. Diligently pay attention to the Word of God. Apply it to your life. Memorize it. Consume it and literally make it a part of you. Study it. Spend time in devotions having the Holy Spirit teach you it. Listen to preaching on it. Read books that heavily utilize it. Do topical searches of it. Examine its words in the original language and diligently follow what you learn from it. Remember the Word of God. Thou hast commanded us to keep Thy precepts diligently. And how shall we know the Lord's precepts unless we study His Word? Verse 5, Oh, that my ways were directed to keep Thy statutes. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep Thy statutes. You may remember times when you have sinned, although a Christian, and thus you cry out to God, Oh, that my ways were directed to keep Thy statutes. That's what I thought of as I studied and prepared on this verse. That even though we've sinned and we are imperfect, we cry out to the Lord, Oh, that my ways were directed to keep Thy statutes. Verse 6, Then shall I not be ashamed when I have respect unto all Thy commandments. Then I shall not be ashamed when I have respect unto all Thy commandments. This verse builds on the last, that if our ways are to keep directed to the statutes of the Lord, then we would not be ashamed and would have respect for all the commandments. Verse 7 says, I will praise Thee with uprightness of heart when I shall have learned Thy righteous judgments. I will praise Thee with uprightness of heart when I shall have learned Thy righteous judgments. Praise the Lord with a pure heart, with a clean heart. The Christian life is meant to be one keeping with repentance. That is, a life opening your heart to the Spirit of God and to the ministry. And as a ministry book I'm reading says, repentance is godly sorrow for sin, followed by a sincere effort to forsake sin. After we have repented and know that our heart is right with God because of the Holy Spirit, our teacher, counselor, and comforter, we can praise the Lord with new joy. Thankful and grateful for the forgiveness and pardon that He has given us, as well as the salvation and new life that we have in Christ Jesus. Whether it began 6 weeks ago or 60 years ago, you can be joyful, thankful, and grateful for what the Lord has done. Verse 8, I will keep Thy statutes, O forsake me not utterly. I will keep Thy statutes, O forsake me not utterly. And this section ends with the writer purposing to keep the Lord's statutes and asking the Lord not to forsake Him. Now we know from the Scripture that the Lord will never leave us or forsake us. But in the Old Testament, the Spirit of God came upon people and left according to God's special purposes for a given time. Saul and David are good examples of that. Perhaps there is a remembrance of that by the writer. I'm not really sure. But nonetheless, we often do feel, even though we have purposed, like crying out to our Father, Oh Lord, don't forsake me. In our humility, we recognize that we are not strong enough, and we need Christ's strength to live like Him, and that we need the empowerment of the Holy Spirit to enable us to follow the Lord faithfully. Remember, do your part. Be responsible. in keeping the Lord's statutes, but also remember, the Lord has promised that he will never leave you nor forsake you. Remember to focus on the mark, Matthew 6:33, and I hope you'll join us for part 2 of Psalm 119. God bless.